A warm welcome, students. So in today's class, we are going to see the HyperLAN. HyperLAN stands for High Performance Radio LAN. So why we go for this HyperLAN is that, so we need to get the high performance through wireless radio LAN. So this WLAN allows a node mobility. Node mobility in sense, many number of nodes are moving in different area, and all are getting signals through wireless medium. So it supports both ad-hoc and infrastructure based topologies. Ad-hoc in sense, we can say that ad-hoc is an infrastructure-less. By the name itself, we can say that many number of nodes can enter the session and many number of nodes can leave the session. Infrastructure in sense, it is a fixed based infrastructure based topologies. So ETSI stands for European Telecommunication Standard Information, ETSI 1996. So in ETSI 1996 European standard, they have given different types of networks. So each and every networks will be supporting for different purposes. So the main future of using this HyperLAN is that it is having a future that time sensitive data transfer services. That means the data rates up to 23.5 Mbps it can support. So next is motivation. Why we learn this HyperLAN? So the motivation to learn this HyperLAN is that today massive growth in wireless and mobile communications. So we need a technology, and in sense we can able to transfer information either in wireless as well as wired medium. So many number of wireless devices are used. So in case of emergence of multimedia applications, not only audio, video, animations, graphics, many more things are there in multimedia applications. So it supports for multimedia applications. HyperLAN demands for high speed internet access. It requires high speed internet access. And another important concept is that deregulation of the telecommunication industry. That is, with respect to ETSI standard, ETSI PAN standard, this HyperLAN works. In sense, we can say that we have either we can use this for approved license, and another one is for unapproved license. Approved license in sense, we are getting an approved license through a public server, thereby they are supporting us with respect to different frequency bands. Unapproved license, that is, we are getting access through free bands. So free bands, we cannot say that we have 100% assurance of safer communication. So for that, we go for approved license. So the standards in HyperLAN is that HyperLAN type 1, HyperLAN type 2, HyperLAN type 3 and HyperLAN type 4. In that HyperLAN 1 and HyperLAN 2, we'd have directly, and the standard of hyper access is nothing but HyperLAN 3. So HyperLAN 3, we can say that it is an hyper access, and HyperLAN 4, we can say that it is an hyperlink. So among these four standards, HyperLAN 2 is very important since it supports two networks, broadband radio access network and wireless ATM. So this HyperLAN 2 supports broadband, radio access networks and wireless ATM. So HyperLAN 2 standard is very important. The main focus with respect to HyperLAN 2, because it has ETSI's European Telecommunication Standards brand network, which is broadband radio access networks and wireless ATM. And next is the history behind this HyperLAN is that HyperLAN supports a data transfer of 23.5 Mbps. So 23.5 Mbps in sense, we can say that data transfer at a very high rate, and which includes different mechanisms, which is forwarding mechanism, packet forwarding mechanism and topology discovery. So either it can follow any kind of topology, star, bus, ring topology, whichever we have learned in the communication networks. And main security is that by providing user data encryption. For example, we have a system at sender and receiver part. We are going to exchange the information through a private key. So that means data encryption standard is achieved. So network identification, which kind of network it belongs to, and power conservation mechanisms all these Hyperland 1 supports. Hyperland 1 operates at a frequency of 5.1 to 5.3 gigahertz at a range of 50 meters in the buildings, and power transmitted is 1 watts. And it is compatible with the standard MAC services such as IEEE 802.x LANs. So we have a mode such as power save mode. So the power save mode is nothing but with respect to P-savers. How this P-savers is achieved? So if we are not using any of the node, that node is said to be simply it is an idle mode. So that idle mode, we have to say that mode as a P-saver mode. P-saver is nothing but it saves some energy. That is, this pattern determines that the node is ready to receive. So other nodes can turn off its receiver and save energy. That energy saver is said to be power savers or P savers. And for supporting that P savers, we need some supporters that is called P supporters, that is power supporters, and that contain information about the wake up and patterns of the P savers. And a P saver only forwards data to a P saver at the moment where the P saver is awake. When the P saver is awake, then only it can able to save the data and forward the data, right? It can support and forward the data. So this is an architecture of ad hoc Hyperland. In this architecture, it has different node. For example, consider this node to be a forwarder node and this node to be an non-forwarder node. So forwarder node in sense, this node can able to retransmit the received packets to its neighbor. So one node is said to be forwarder node. So other node is said to be non-forwarder node. We need to understand what is forwarder node and non-forwarder node. So in forwarder node in sense, by the name itself, we can say that it will forward the packets. So whenever a packet is sent from sender to receiver system, that is the neighboring system, it will send the packet. Once a packet is lost, it will retransmits received packets to its neighbors. Retransmits received packets to its neighbors. That is said to be forwarder node. And what is a non-forwarder node? Non-forwarder node is that it simply accepts a packet which deserves to it. Simply accepts the packets that is deserved. So that is, we can say that this non-forwarder node at least maintains one neighbor. Okay, one neighbor between the different nodes connected. So here forwarder node is in sense it retransmits a packet, received packets to its neighbor, but it's not having condition that it can maintain any one number of neighbor. But here in non-forwarder node, it will maintain at least one neighbor. So next is the physical and MAC layers of Hyperland 1. This is the OSI layer. OSI layer stands for Open System Interconnection Model. Comparing the Open System Interconnection Model with the classical model with the Hyperland model. So when you compare that, you have 7 layers: physical layer, data link layer, network layer, transport layer, session layer, presentation layer, and application layer. So this physical layer will be same as the Hyperland physical layer. And the data link layer will be divided into medium access control layer and logical link control layer. So we are going to see the medium access control layer and logical link control layer. So here we are going to access this MAC layer through 3 different phases. One is prioritization phase, another one contention phase, another last one is nothing but transition phase. So in priority phase, we will assign the priority and we will detect. And in transmission phase, it will about to transmit the data packets. In contention phase, it has to wait and then it can transmit. So we are going to see what are the things present here. So first is nothing but here we follow a standard called the EYNPMA. EY stands for Elimination Yield Non-Preemptive Priority Multiple Access. So here we can say that it is an heart of the channel which access different priorities and provides different access schemes. So here this elimination yield non-primitive multiple access, which divides a medium of different competing nodes into three phases. So one is prioritization phase, another one contention phase, then is transmission phase. So in prioritization phase, it will assign the data with respect to highest priority. For example, we can say that we have data packets with respect to slot 0, slot 1, slot 2, slot 3 and slot 4. Slot 0 is of highest priority and slot 4 is of lowest priority, right? Why? Because this will be the slots reserved. So here in the prioritization phase, it will those packets which have a highest priority will be sent first, and then the lowest priority will be sent next. That will be done in the prioritization phase. That is, you have to process priority detection and priority assertion. So in priority detection and priority assertion, it will be divided into slots with respect to IPS and IPA. So I'll explain this later. So next is the contention phase. So it will eliminate all the one of the contenders, but more than one center has the highest current priority. So that will be the contention phase. Then transmission phase is that finally the data packet which is ready to transmit to the next neighboring node, it will transmit the packet. So in contention phase, we have two things to be subdivided. One is elimination phase, another one is yield phase. So I'll explain this here. For example, this is a slot of data. This is slot 0, slot 1, slot 2, slot 3 and slot 4. I told this slot is said to be having highest priority, and this slot is nothing but lowest priority. So when we go for this highest priority and lowest priority, in sense each and every slot will be having with respect to IPS. IPS is nothing but priority. So for priority selection, we have 168 bit periods. So IPS value will be 168 bit periods. That is, each and every slot will be having a duration of priority value, which is to be 168 bit periods. And then next is nothing but priority assertion. So how the priority will be given is that it will have listen to medium for P slots. So the channel will listen to the medium for P slots. So after listening to the channel to the medium for P slots, then what it will do is it will do the priority detection. So PD stands for priority detection. So after the priority is detected, then what happens is that the node will sense for the channel. The node will sense for the channel. So after sensing the channel, when the channel is found to be idle, it will able to transmit the packets. If the channel is busy, then what happens is it will send a burst packets. That is said to be when IPA value was 168 bits high rate, 168 bit high rate data packets with respect to different bit periods. That is priority assertion taken place. So after this, priority assertion will be provided. So after priority assertion provided, once the burst signal is sent, this will be the pattern of the burst signal. You can repeatedly once followed by different zeros and ones, different zeros and ones, etc. So this is not a standard format. You can based upon the priority, it will form the burst packets. That is, after the burst signal sent, the priority assertion is taken place. After the priority assertion, it will able to transmit the data. So this is the elimination yield non-preemptive multiple access. So priority resolution, contention resolution and then transmission. So first it will find the highest priority from the different time slots. First it will send to the first phase, and then higher the priority, the earlier time slot to send. When the priority is higher, it will send it earlier. When the priority is low, it will send after the highest priority. So higher priorities cannot be preempted. So we cannot say that the meaning for preempted is that the time taken action to prevent that. So we cannot prevent, since higher priority cannot be prevented. So because of this time slot for the higher priority, it cannot be preempted. So for the stations, it will transmit the packets from the next low priority will be sent then. So after the first phase, the highest current priority has been determined. So next is contention phase. That is, in contention phase, we have elimination first. In elimination phase, we have elimination survival verification. So all the terminals, remaining terminals, will send a burst to eliminate condensers. So condensers, in sense, it will sense the channel. When the channel is idle, that is free, they can continue. Otherwise, it will be eliminated. Then yield phase. So waiting for the yield listening, condensers again listens in slots which waits for non-zero probability. Then the terminal sends its slot to be idle, and then it will transmit the data. So data transmission phase, the winner can send now its data with respect to the, without using the EY-MPMA. So your next topic is wireless ATM, which is wireless asynchronous transfer mode. We'll see it in the next session. Thank you.